รายการต่อไปนี้เป็นรายการทั่วไปสามารถรับชมได้ทุกวัย
สนับสนุนโดย
แลกเงินด้วยบัตรเครดิตกสิกรไทยเที่ยวก่อนจ่ายทีหลังไม่มีค่าธรรมเนียมผ่อนชำระได้จากธนาคารกสิกรไทย
สวัสดีค่ะคุณชาร์ลส์โบเดนผู้อำนวยการองค์การนาซาเดินทางมาเมืองไทยเมื่อเร็วๆนี้นะคะเพื่อที่จะเปิดตัวโครงการเซอร์เวียแม่โขงซึ่งเป็นโครงการในการหาข้อมูลจากดาวเทียมมาใช้ให้เกิดประโยชน์ค่ะนั่นก็คือรวบรวมข้อมูลเพื่อที่จะรับมือกับภาวะโลกร้อนและภัยพิบัติทางธรรมชาติต่างๆที่อาจจะเกิดขึ้นนะคะและนอกจากมาเปิดตัวโครงการนี้คุณชาร์ลส์โบเดนยังได้พูดเพื่อสร้างแรงบันดาลใจให้กับเยาวชนไทยด้วยค่ะดิฉันได้พูดคุยกับคุณชาร์ลส์โบเดนนะคะหลากหลายประเด็นด้วยกันทั้งความสำคัญของโครงการเซอร์เวียแม่โขงรวมถึงภารกิจของนาซาในการส่งคนไปยังดาวอังคารและความประทับใจของเขาในสมัยที่เป็นนักบินอวกาศค่ะ
ชาร์ลส์โบเดนวัย69ปีจบการศึกษาระดับปริญญาตรีด้านวิทยาศาสตร์ไฟฟ้าจากโรงเรียนในเรือในปี1968และระดับปริญญาโทด้านการจัดการระบบจากมหาวิทยาลัยซาวเทิร์นแคลิฟอร์เนียในปี1977โบเดนทำงานกับนาวิกโยธินสหรัฐยาวนานถึง34ปีเขาเคยเป็นนักบินกองทัพเรือและในช่วงปี1972ถึง1973เขาได้ปฏิบัติภารกิจบินสู้รบมากกว่า100สมรภูมิในเวียดนามเหนือเวียดนามใต้ลาวและกัมพูชาโดยมีฐานที่มั่นอยู่ที่เมืองไทยในปี1980โบเดนเข้าทำงานที่สำนักงานนักบินอวกาศของนาซาเขาเคยเดินทางไปสำรวจอวกาศ4ครั้งและหลังจากทำงานที่นาซานาน14ปีเขาได้กลับไปทำงานกับหน่วยนาวิกโยธินสหรัฐก่อนที่ประธานาธิบดีโอบามาจะแต่งตั้งให้เขาเป็นผู้อำนวยการคนที่12ขององค์การนาซาในปี2009
Charles, what is the ultimate goal of NASA? To explore so that humans can move and live on other planets or to extract resources from other planets and use it on Earth or what is the ultimate goal?
If you ask me in broad perspective what is NASA's ultimate goal, I would sort of paraphrase our vision, which says thatyou know, we live in such that what we reach for higher heights so that the things that we learn and the things that we do make life better here on Earth. And that's it in a nutshell. Now, how do we do that? We do it through human exploration, going to other places in our solar system as we're trying right now to get humans to Mars by the 2030s so that we can actually explore another planet in this solar systemto help us understand even better our own planet Earth, as we did when we went to the moon. We do it through science and scientific collaboration, mainly with other countries, as we're doing here in Thailand right now with Servier. If you look at aeronautics, just flying airplanes back and forth, how do we make it safer for people to fly in space? How do we enable people to keep track of basic things? How do you keep track of airplanes so that we don't lose airplanes suddenly in midair and have them disappear?How do we get unmanned aerial systems, drones, how do we get them introduced into controlled airspace such that they can fly safely as if they had a pilot on board? So those are all things that NASA does.
แม้ว่า NASA จะเป็นหน่วยงานที่ได้รับงบประมาณสูงในช่วงที่มีโครงการอพอลโลแต่ต่อมาในปี2012 NASA ต้องยุติโครงการทดลองทางอวกาศหลายโครงการหลังจากถูกรัฐบาลสหรัฐตัดงบประมาณลงกว่า120เนื่องจากเห็นว่าเป็นรายจ่ายที่ไม่จำเป็น
Is the US somehow losing out on space technology compared to other countries because of budget cuts?
Yeah, you know, actually we are not losing out. Every nation in the world today finds that none of us are spending enough on research and development. None of us are spending enough on technology development.
NASA talks a lot about knowledge sharing.But do you actually share what you discover with other space programs of other countries, especially Russians or
you know,
the Chinese?
One of the best things about NASA is that everything we do is open source. So when we make an agreement with another nation, whether it's China or Russia or anyone, One of the stipulations of that agreement is that all the data collected will go into an open source international database. So if you partner with NASA, you're agreeing that whatever is found out is going to go into a database that's available to the general public. We don't have anything that people can't gain unless it's something that has come out of research that we're doing with a private corporation, say a big aeronautics company. Sometimes they have things that they consider to be proprietary data, so they can hold on to that. But most things that NASA does goes into the public domain.
Along with a number of เมื่อปลายเดือนสิงหาคมที่ผ่านมาองค์การ NASA และองค์การเพื่อการพัฒนาระหว่างประเทศของสหรัฐอเมริกาหรือ USAID ได้เปิดตัวโครงการเซอร์เบียแม่โขงซึ่งเป็นโครงการที่ส่งเสริมการใช้ภาพถ่ายดาวเทียมในการช่วยให้ประเทศในกลุ่มแม่น้ำโขงตอนล่างของเอเชียสามารถคาดการณ์และรับมือกับภัยพิบัติได้โครงการเซอร์เบียแม่โขงนี้ได้รับการสนับสนุนทุนโดย NASA USAID และดำเนินการโดยศูนย์เตรียมความพร้อมป้องกันภัยพิบัติแห่งเอเชีย
You're in Thailand right now to launch the Severe Mekong project.
Yes.
What is the role that NASA plays in this, and how would this project contribute to the growth and development of Thailand and the region?
Severe is a project that, or is a network that brings nations of like mind together, or like that have like problems. NASA works with the U.S. Agency for International Development. We're a support agency, so the U.S. Agency for International Development is actually the controlling agency for SEVEAR. We provide scientists and engineers. We provide the data through our orbiting satellites that comes into the hub here in Bangkok and is made available to policymakers throughout the region. So our hope is that your government, for example, will decide that they'd like to use this data, that they want to make sure that droughts and floods that are going to alternately affect Thailand, they're a little bit more aware of and they can plan for, that they can make predictions on floods that occur with the monsoon rains that come and go, such that they can keep their people safer, by migrating people away from flood areas at a particular time that we know it's going to happen every year. We can help farmers because they can make better plans on how to plant their crops, so their crop planning is much more smart, and they get more, the crop yield is better than it would be normally. If you're looking at fresh water, how do we get water? Water resources management.
ในการมาเปิดตัวโครงการเซอร์เบียแม่โขงของสหรัฐในไทยครั้งนี้มีการตั้งคำถามว่าสหรัฐต้องการใช้โครงการเซอร์เบียแม่โขงในการเก็บข้อมูลเพื่อใช้ทางการทหารหรือเพื่อสอดส่องน่านฟ้าของจีนหรือไม
่ NASA is a part of the Civil Space Program in the United States, and SEVEAR is a program that comes out of that Civil Space Program where we cooperate with other nations of the world looking at primarily at climate change. What can we do about making it more viable for farmers to develop their crop yield? How do we look at water resources management? That's the primary focus of SEVEAR. It has nothing to do with gathering information on people, but gathering information on the environment to keep people safe. China is a part of one of the SEVEAR hubs. They're a part of SEVEAR Himalayas because in that particular region, China participates in the environmental center in which SEVEAR is located. So China actually uses some of the SEVEAR data to try to do the same kinds of things that every other nation in that region. There, they're looking primarily at water resources. How do they effectively capture the water that's coming down from the melt from the Himalayas, such that there are 10 different very major rivers that who get their water from the Himalayas, and how do you better control that water, and how do you better manage it? And that's one of the things that SEVEAR tries to do in SEVEAR in the Himalayas.
วันที่14กรกฎาคมที่ผ่านมา NASA ได้ถ่ายทอดสดวินาทีประวัติศาสตร์ที่ยานอวกาศ New Horizons ได้เดินทางผ่านดาวเคราะห์แคระพลูโตเป็นครั้งแรกหลังจากใช้เวลาเดินทางนานกว่า9ปีโดยได้ถ่ายภาพดาวพลูโตจากระยะที่ใกล้ที่สุดส่งกลับมายังโลกยานอวกาศ New Horizons
ถือเป็นยานอวกาศลำแรกที่เข้าใกล้ดาวพลูโตมากที่สุดและทำให้นาซาสำรวจดาวในระบบสุริยะได้ครบทุกดวง
Let's talk about space.
Yes.
What is the biggest lesson that we learned from New Horizons journey on mission to Pluto?
Pluto, New Horizons. I don't know if we know what the biggest lesson that we will learn from Pluto, New Horizons. That we're in the infant stage of evaluating the data from New Horizons. We just had our closest approach of Pluto a little bit more than a month ago with New Horizons. It's a spacecraft that launched more than 9 years ago and has gone more than 3 billion miles to get to Pluto. So it completed the suite of visits that the United States has now made to every single planet and dwarf planet in our solar system. The United States now actually has a satellite called Viking Voyager that's out of our solar system and now into interplanetary space. And we're busy around every planet in the solar system trying to learn more about it to help us understand better our own Earth and its history, how it was formed. For example, Curiosity on the surface of Mars is looking at structures, the geological history of Mars, in hopes that we'll learn a little bit more about our own Earth.
So what's the next exciting mission or journey for NASA?
Oh, there is always an exciting journey ongoing. The International Space Station today is something that on which we're very heavily focused because we've got about 10 years now left with not quite that much time, but some period of time left with the International Space Station to learn as much as we can about the long-term impact on the human body of long-duration space flight in a microgravity environment. To develop technologies that will enable us to migrate away from low Earth orbit into lunar orbit for a period of about 10 years as we perfect the technologies that we're going to need to send humans onto Mars and also understand a little bit more about the human body and its effects. What's great about this exploration and this research that's going on the International Space Station is that almost everything that we learn there is applicable to things down here on Earth, whether it's talking about osteoporosis, the embrittlement of human bones, a problem that generally is seen most in women in aging. We are now understanding more and more about osteoporosis. Astronauts go through something very similar when they go into space. Because of the lack of gravity, the bones can tend to lose minerals and the like. We have learned how to counteract that with exercise, with diet, and with medication. And we use the same things here on Earth to help people who are suffering from things like osteoporosis. We see a modern phenomena is degradation in visual acuity, loss of your ability to see things as clearly as you saw them when you were down here on Earth because of a condition that we call increased interocular pressure, intracranial pressure, increased pressure in the brain that squeezes down on the optical nerve. We're learning that is not a microgravity only phenomena, but it's something that we actually see in people down here on Earth. So we're taking the benefit of medical research on Earth, medical research that's going on the International Space Station to try to solve this problem that will help people both on Earth and astronauts operating in space.
And so by 2030, NASA will send astronauts to Mars, is that right?
It is the hope that NASA, in collaboration with our international partners, it's not going to be a U.S. mission. It will be exploration from here on out is going to be the collaboration of many nations of the world working together. It is not something that any one nation can do. So people like to talk about competition a lot and who's first, who's second. We talk about collaboration. The competition for us is competition of ideas. Where do we go and in what order? Those are ideas that we and our international partners discuss all the time. Should we focus our efforts on getting to Mars and do as much as we can on the way there? That's the way that we in the United States think. That if we focus on getting to Mars and we put all of our efforts into that, we're going to spend about 10 years orbiting our moon again. During that period of time, it's my hope that we will be able to collaborate with some of our international partners, whether they're Russia, or whether they're entrepreneurs, or whether they're American or foreign countries, that will help to provide a lander that will put humans back on the surface of the moon again while we're working to get humans onto Mars.
Do you believe in aliens and UFOs?
I'm not a big alien fan. I do believe there is life elsewhere in our solar system. I believe there's life elsewhere in the universe. And I think that we're pretty close to demonstrating that, to proving that it exists. When we talk about life, though, the reason I say I'm not a big fan of aliens, we We have taught children to be afraid of aliens, monsters and the like. What we're looking for is the fact that there is life elsewhere in our solar system, that there are single cell microbes. Just think of what that will mean for humanity if we find that there is the very beginning of life. You know, we believe that life here on Earth, some of us do, the most of us who took science and believe it, we believe but that life evolved to where it is today. Just imagine what it does to our thinking about the entire universe if we find that in the oceans of Europa, a moon of Jupiter, that there is a single cell microbe, or that we find as Curiosity is climbing up Mount Sharp and looking at the various layers in the geological history of Mars, that we come across a fossil of a single cell microorganism. That completely changes the game and revolutionizes our understanding of the history of humanity itself. When you're going into outer space, believe it or not, I am always a little nervous, one, but you have a long time to lay in the spacecraft while you wait. You crawl into your spacecraft even today, and you kind of lay there in your seat and you wait for several hours to launch. It only takes 8.5 minutes to get to space. It's relatively gentle. It's not violent like you would think. You're shaken and everything, but it's relatively gentle. It doesn't feel as violent as you would think.
Did you ever get bored as an astronaut?
Never ever. Did I ever get bored as an astronaut? Never ever 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 ever. As a matter of fact, in my 4 flights, they were all different. Every time you go, you're incredibly much more informed and much more acclimated to flying in space. But every flight was different for some reason. You know, my second flight was when we deployed the Hubble Space Telescope, and we were singly focused on getting Hubble deployed. My third flight was the first mission to planet Earth that NASA flew, where we had 13 experiments on board. 10 of them looked at Earth's atmosphere, actually looked at what's called the mesosphere, Earth's middle atmosphere, trying to understand, you know, how does weather really happen and stuff like that. And then 3 of them were looking at the sun. And then my 4th and final flight was the first joint Russian-American shuttle mission, which was absolutely incredible. So 4 unbelievable experiences, uniquely different in every respect, so never got bored.
What is your most memorable moment in space?
I don't know that I have a single most memorable moment, but the thing that I try to share with students and others as I travel around the world is one image, and it's an image of the Middle East that was taken. It's one frame from a series of frames of the Middle East taken after we deployed the Hubble Space Telescope, that shows the Middle East, which many people consider to be one of the most violent parts of the world, but in all its grandeur and beauty, just absolutely spectacular, and it caused me to float there and wonder if it really looks like that. There are no borders, no boundaries. It looks like people down there could be living in harmony. Why is it not really like that? So I think that's in essence, that's the most memorable image that I tend to take from all my space experiences, is the image of this world as one ocean, one planet, in unity, in peace. And then come back to Earth and try to make it so.
It's beautiful, right?
It is absolutely breathtaking.
How should parents and teachers actually encourage students or their children and nurture their dreams to become astronauts like you in Thailand when we don't even have a space program?
You don't have to have a space program to encourage students to study and to work really hard and to dream big dreams. And you just said it yourself. How do you do that? You believe in it. If you're a parent, you allow your child to be exposed as often as you can to anything that they might not ordinarily come across. Go to the exhibits in the museum. Have them, when they go down to the beach or whatever it is, to kind of pay attention to what's going on. When they see a starfish that floats up on the seashore, have them ask a question about it. Where does that come from? How does it work? How does it live? What does it eat? Those kinds of things. Have them become very curious about what goes on around them. Help them understand that the climate is changing, for example. Does it have to? Is there something that we can do to make it better? Yes, there is. And the answer that that a parent ought to tell a child if they say, is there anything we can do, is yes, we can. When I was a kid, I was really small. I was a little kid, and I always wanted to do big things. And people said, but you can't do that because you're not the right size. Or back in my school growing up, we had something called segregation where they kept people apart because of their race. Or young ladies in here, frequently you're told you can't do something because girls don't do that. Don't listen to anybody that tells you that. Don't be afraid that you're gonna fail because you're too small, you're a girl in a man's world, or you came from the wrong part of Thailand. Don't be afraid of failure. Now, what do I mean by that? Life is full of failures. If I had a quarter, or whatever the denomination of money is in Thailand, if I had that for every time I fail, I'd probably be rich. But life is full of failures. Do not be afraid of failing. Thanks so very much for letting me spend time with you. Thank you.
จากการพูดคุยกับคุณชาลส์โบเดนนะคะทำให้เราเห็นภาพชัดเจนเลยล่ะค่ะว่าการวิจัยหรือว่าทดลองต่างๆในอวกาศซึ่งอาจจะห่างไกลในแง่ของระยะทางแต่ว่าจริงๆแล้วประโยชน์ที่เกิดขึ้นนั้นใกล้ตัวมากเอามาใช้บนโลกนี่แหละค่ะไม่ว่าจะเป็นเรื่องของการเข้าใจเรื่องของสภาพอากาศมากยิ่งขึ้นหรือว่าไปใช้ในการแพทย์เพื่อค้นหาวิธีการรักษาโรคต่างๆนะคะที่สำคัญคุณชาลส์โบเดนยังเป็นตัวอย่างที่ดีด้วยสำหรับคนที่กล้าคิดกล้าทำแล้วก็ไม่กลัวที่จะล้มเหลวด้วยค่ะซึ่งตรงนี้ล่ะค่ะเป็นสิ่งสำคัญที่ทำให้มนุษย์เราสามารถไปได้ไกลถึงในอวกาศนะคะพบกันใหม่สัปดาห์หน้าวันนี้สวัสดีค่ะ